pig.
There are some things in life that you just don't see coming. The world is random, unpredictable. Unlikely things can happen. So are you blessed with good fortune? Or are you one of the unlucky ones? But maybe there is a way through this mess of chance. Maybe the secret to being lucky is in trusting the math. Okay, Roz, you study the mathematics of disease, right? How much of it is luck and chance?
Well, there's a lot of chance that's involved in the transmission of disease. So if there's an epidemic happening at the moment, the chance of you getting it depends on how many other people there are that have the infection at the time. And then if you happen to meet one of those, which is more likely when there's a lot of people who have it, there's also a chance you'll get it from them or not. And if you have some pre-existing immunity, maybe you've been vaccinated or you've had it before, then the chance of them passing it to you also goes down. So there's a lot.
So then how can maths help you?
It's really difficult to predict on an individual level if somebody will get it. But on a population level with these nice big numbers, there's some things we can predict. When the epidemic will go up and when it will come down, we try and predict the peak and we try and predict which groups might be at risk of infection.
Well, talking of epidemics, there are some rumours of a zombie apocalypse about to hit. Okay, so everyone here, underneath your seats, you should have a zombie mask and you should have some ping pong balls. Now these are your zombie germs. Mm-hmm. So how it works is if a zombie germ touches you, you become a zombie, you put up your zombie mask, and then you take your zombie germs and you throw them straight up in the air as high as you possibly can, okay? And in a moment, I'm gonna start off this infection. So everyone start with your mask down to kick us off. I'm gonna start this infection. Here's the zombie germs coming at you. I'm directly targeting people. Okay, ooh, already. So we've got a few different patches here.
We do, yeah. But it's starting to get a little bit frightening around here. We use similar type of methods, using chance to pass on infection to understand how real diseases spread around. But for zombie infections, nobody ever recovers.
Nobody, okay.
And that's in the real world, people usually recover.
I think there are, in fact, okay, so if you, it's still going.
It is still going. Okay.
If you are not a zombie, could you stand up for us? How many people are there?
Oh, we've got
just
some.
Three people who managed to escape the zombie battle. You also can't target people directly with your zombie germs. That wasn't part of the rules.
No,
okay, everybody sit down. Thank you very much.
Well done.
Now, we can do this again, mm-hmm. but this time we can use some kind of zombie defences.
Exactly, yeah. So over here, there's going to be some protection against infection. And these people are going to be completely protected.
Okay, so those of you who have, you've got protective masks under your seat. And this makes you completely immune from zombie infections.
It does, yep.
Okay, so those of you who have, you've got protective masks under your seat. And this makes you completely immune from zombie infections.
It does, yep.
Okay, so if the zombie germs touch you and you're wearing a face mask, you're wearing a protective mask, don't worry about anything. Don't put up your zombie mask. Don't throw any germs around. You're completely immune. And we'll see what happens now. And what's your prediction about what will happen in this case?
Well, there's a lot of protection up here, so I think the epidemic will be over very quickly, and maybe not many people will be infected.
Okay, let's give it a go. Here we go. Okay. So it still started. We've got a few. Oh.
Oh.
Okay. I mean, that stopped almost immediately. Okay, so those of you who are not wearing a protective mask, but are also not a zombie, could you stand up? Oh, goodness me, look at that.
Wow, it's a lot.
And there's a point to it. Thank you very much, Owen, you can sit down. There's a point to all of this, right?
Yeah, exactly. So the protection that we had in the population from the people wearing masks who are vaccinated against infection has protected everybody in this part of the audience from getting infection.
And is this the same thing that happens when we're vaccinated against diseases?
Exactly, it is. So we have here kind of this community has immunity from infection. And so even the people who weren't themselves vaccinated have been protected by the protection in the whole community.
So how much does the maths of modelling disease make a difference back in the real world?
So we take experiments kind of like this, but in the computer, and take things that we know about how infection spreads and about the population in general. And the goal is to use the computers, use our simulations, to figure out ahead of time what would be the best interventions. What should we do to decrease the number of cases in everybody without it having to happen?
So it doesn't matter whether you're talking about flus or Ebola or, I don't know, TB in cows. You can use these mathematical ideas.
Yeah, for human diseases, for animal diseases, even for plants, it's really useful.
And demonstrates that vaccines really do make a difference.
It does. It does. Would you rather live over here with all these zombies or over here?
Definitely over
Definitely
there.
Over here.
Roz, thank you very much.
Thank you.
There is a really simple point in all of this. If you've got maths on your side, it's not just about spotting patterns. It's about using what the numbers tell you to bend the world to your will.
If you've got maths on your side, it's not just about spotting patterns, it's about using what the numbers tell you to bend the world to your will. Is this yet more crazy prescience from Hannah Fry, or just another one of those spooky coincidences? In my last video, I sifted the evidence concerning the BBC pandemic simulation exercise of 2017, in which Hannah Fry starred as the asymptomatic super spreader, patient zero. Her role was to seed a fictitious respiratory virus around the small market town of Haslemere in the south of England, and from there a smartphone map downloaded by thousands of volunteers was used to track the spread of the deadly pathogen across the UK. Then, in February 2020, the BBC News reported that, in a bizarre twist of fate, Haslemere happened to be the very location of the UK's patient zero for COVID-19. Hannah Fry's reaction to finding herself at the centre of such a weird news story was one of genuine shock. She was clearly freaked out by the revelation, and here she expresses her struggle to make sense of it.
My guest today is Hannah Fry, the UK's best known mathematician. She applies maths to human behaviour and looks for patterns in places you wouldn't expect to find them. In fact, she may even be able to see the future, given 2 years ago she used maths to predict the effects of a global pandemic. Hannah, welcome to my digital studio. In 2018, you released a documentary called Contagion. It aired in the UK that year and has recently come to Australia through SBS On Demand. In that film, you pretty much predicted the situation we are now in. How uncanny does it feel to be living through something you've simulated as an experiment?
Well, I wouldn't say it's a nice experience. uncanny really is the word. I'd say almost eerie, because I mean, I think that we all knew that something like this was coming. You know, this isn't a surprise. All of the experts have been talking about the risk of a pandemic for years. And in fact, actually in 2017, when we made that programme, a pandemic was number one on the list of the UK government's risk register. So pandemics were always a risk. What's really eerie about the programme, which was essentially a big citizen science experiment in which we simulated a pandemic spreading across the UK, an epidemic spreading across the UK, and see what that would look like. What was really eerie was that the way we set it up in the programme was that I was patient zero, and we picked a town in the south of England. We picked Hazelmere, this very small town, and that ended up being the very first place that there was domestic transmission in the UK. So eerie experience. But...
eerie indeed. As a professional mathematician, she, of all people, knows how very unlikely it is that this happened by chance. And yet, despite her self-professed enthusiasm for delving into and solving mysteries, she seems strangely reluctant to explore the one that landed right into her lap. So I will ask the question on her behalf. Was Hannah Fry groomed and duped into foretelling a key moment in the unfolding of the COVID pandemic? And if so, by whom? The Royal Institute Christmas Lectures were started in 1825 by Michael Faraday and are now broadcast on national television to an audience of eager youngsters. Each year, a leading academic of the day is chosen to present the lectures, and in 2019, this honour was bestowed upon Hannah Fry. Her lectures were entitled Secrets and Lies, The Hidden Power of Maths. And lo and behold, just a few weeks later, a self-styled club of UK academics calling themselves the COVID-19 Response Team, led by Professor Neil Ferguson, was indeed using the hidden power of maths to bend the world to their will. Coronavirus, UK changes course amid death toll fears. 17th of March 2020. Change course or a quarter of a million people will die in a catastrophic epidemic of coronavirus. The crucial piece of evidence came from the scientists at Imperial College London, whose advice is heavily influential in government. The modelling projected that if the UK did nothing, 81% of people would be infected and 510,000 would die from coronavirus by August. Going back to the 2019 Christmas lecture, this promotion shot of Hannah covering her right eye with a peacock feather is very striking. And she talks about the date it was taken on her Instagram page. Big old day today. We're filming the Royal Institution Christmas lectures this evening. These things have been going for nearly 200 years. An intimidating array of science giants have hosted them in the past. Faraday, Attenborough, Sagan, Roberts and Scott. And now me. They'll be on BBC4 from Boxing Day onwards. Tune in to discover how it all goes. P.S. This photo from the promo photoshoot doesn't actually have much to do with anything, but the colours look excellent with my hair, and we all know that's what's really important here. I have to admit that I'm not entirely sure what to make of this last throwaway comment. It sounds a little awkward, like she feels the need to explain. I can imagine that at the photo shoot that day, with so much happening around her and so much expected of her, that she was not fully focused on what was going on. Did someone hand her the feather and instruct her to hold it over her right eye, perhaps adding the flattering comment, "It goes great with your hair"? She probably thought little of it at the time. And the photo certainly fits in with the overall mysterious, occultish branding for the show. But as a couple of her followers on Instagram were quick to point out, The peacock feather is replete with symbolism, as is the act of covering the right eye, both of which I will explore in depth later. But first I want to go back to that zombie apocalypse demonstration. Hannah is clearly in her element here, and it is one of the better demonstrations of the lecture, involving a good proportion of the kids in the audience, who are all attentive, engaged and having a laugh. Had I been in the audience at their age, I know I would have loved it, and that it would have left a lasting impression on me. When, not long later, news of an epidemic in the real world hit, I'm pretty sure I would have dutifully donned my magic muzzle and preached to the adults around me on the science of vaccination from the Gospel according to Sage. Would I also have fallen for the shameless flattery of the likes of Jonathan Van Tam that I was mature enough and wise enough to go against my parents' wishes and decide for myself to roll up my sleeve for the experimental injection? Yes, I think I would. Such is the power of trusted role models like Hannah Fry. Speaking of Jonathan Van Tam, look at who's next up to present the Christmas lectures. Going viral, how COVID changed science forever. Change science forever. How absurdly hubristic is that? And yet I'm sure he is confident that the kids and their parents and their teachers will hang on his every word. There's one more observation I want to make about this demonstration. Since when did zombie apocalypse become the go-to light-hearted scenario for illustrating viral contagion to kids? I first encountered this when I came across the American CDC's zombie preparedness website, so I guess the idea came from there. Wonder why zombies, zombie apocalypse, and zombie preparedness continue to live or walk dead on the CDC website. As it turns out, what first began as a tongue-in-cheek campaign to engage new audiences with preparedness messages has proven to be a very effective platform. It's been going on since 2011 and has been rolled out on a wide scale, particularly targeting educators such as teachers, scout leaders, librarians, and public health ambassadors. Then there's this. Our graphic novel, Preparedness 101, Zombie Pandemic, demonstrates the importance of being prepared in an entertaining way that people of all ages will enjoy. Now, I find this merging of fiction with reality aimed at children by the establishment more than a little disturbing. When the January 2020 headlines of coronavirus zombies in Wuhan surfaced, how many of the children who'd watched the Christmas lectures remembered that demonstration and felt afraid for their lives? But no need to fear, they had already been primed to believe that science had the answer. A magic blue mask and a miracle injection would save them. Let's go back to the question, was Hannah Fry groomed and duped into foretelling a key moment in the unfolding of the COVID pandemic? And if so, by whom? I believe she was, and that some of the clues lie here in the 2019 Royal Institution Christmas Lectures promo shoot. All of the photos taken that day are credited to Paul Wilkinson, but I drew a blank when I tried to dig into his career and background. This arresting image of Hannah standing on a black and white tiled floor, photographed from directly above, is impossible to look at without thinking of the checkered flooring of a Freemasonic temple. While watching the first lecture, I recognised the floor and the angle from which it was taken. So it looks like the photographer was standing on that staircase pointing the camera at Hannah below. This might seem innocent enough, but the image has clearly been processed in such a way as to make the checkerboard tiles a focal point and then cropped and framed to evoke a strong impression of a temple floor. The meaning of the checkered floor is not easy to discern. This 2012 blogspot from Exposing the Matrix has this to say. Black and white is a symbol for duality, or the base of consciousness. Base consciousness is important because it is where all other states of mind arise. Personally, I like to think that checkerboards are also symbols for the celebrities being pawns. Hannah really does look like a pawn to me on that checkerboard floor, and I'm pretty sure that's the intention of the photograph. Going back to this, when I first came across this picture in March 2020, I was still reeling from the sudden jolt of realization brought about by the spooky Hazelmere coincidence. Seeing it caused me yet another jolt as I recognized that there was indeed something deeply sinister at play, so it took a while for me to regain my equilibrium enough to start exploring its meaning. I was already somewhat familiar with the one-eye hidden symbolism so beloved of A-list celebrities, musicians and sports stars, but I wasn't entirely sure of its meaning. After a bit of searching, I found this succinct explanation which rings true to me. One-eye hidden is basically a salute to the elite to let them know they are in allegiance with them and willing to push the assigned agenda, similar to throwing up gang signs. Zechariah 11:17 references the Antichrist will be blind in his right eye. Although it deviates slightly, most doing the sign cover their right eye. Delving deeper, I found biblical references cropping up time and again. As someone of a secular atheist persuasion, my instinct in the past was to overlook or dismiss these pointers, but the dramatically shifting sands of early 2020 caused me to realise that I shouldn't be so hasty. It is pretty clear that, as with the celebrity porn chessboard images, these one-eye hidden photoshoots are more than just artistic expression. Some of the heavyweights know full well what they are doing and what it means, and it is a pretty sick game. Others further down the chain are probably less aware, but they are keen to please and will go along with whatever their promotion team ask of them. Judging by Hannah Fry's account of this photoshoot, I doubt she understood the significance, but she comes across as somewhat uneasy about the image. And now to the symbolism of the peacock feather. I have to admit to spending more time than is good for me chasing down all the possible meanings of this symbol, but I did in the end land upon fairly solid ground. So here goes. The most obvious parallel between Freemason imagery and the peacock feather is the all-seeing eye, or eye of providence, and I had to look no further than Wikipedia for the basics on that. Today, the Eye of Providence is often associated with Freemasonry. In this use, the eye, representing the all-seeing eye of God, serves as a reminder that humanity's thoughts and deeds are always observed by God, who is referred to in Masonry as the great architect of the universe. There are, of course, a lot more avenues to explore here. In particular, the association between the Eye of Providence and the ancient Egyptian Eye of Horus. But I will cut to the chase here and say that I don't believe the peacock feather in this image represents the all-seeing eye at all, but rather it represents that mythical firebird, the phoenix. And here's why. First, there is a clearly established link between the peacock and the phoenix across many cultures and religions. In Christianity, both the peacock and the phoenix are used to symbolize Christ's death and resurrection. And in China, The peacock is another manifestation of the heavenly phoenix on earth. It is one of the 12 symbols of sovereignty. According to the Catholic Church, the symbolic meaning of the peacock represents immortality and resurrection. The early Christians, many of them Greek, immediately saw in the phoenix an image of the resurrection. For this reason, it is frequently depicted near Christian burial places and is a favourite symbol of the early church. But then there's this.
This is a very important cathedral in Europe, in Germany, where all the political leaders come together. These are symbols that are prevalent in the world. There's Jesus standing above the skull and crossbones, which is a symbol of Jupiter, the god Jupiter, who is a symbol, of course, who is Lucifer. Upside down crosses again. If you enter into the hallway, you find this over here. This is the god Anubis. It's got nothing to do with Christianity. There you have him as well. Plus you have the phoenix rising from the ashes. Plus you have the symbol of Jupiter and a whole host of other symbols over there. And in their side chapel, you have all the signs of the zodiac serving the various deities like Mars and Aquarius, etc. And the doorknob is a yin-yang. This has nothing to do with Christianity. They use the symbol of the compass and Jupiter and the PX symbol over there, which you will find in virtually every single Christian denomination upon the face of the earth. The phoenix rising from the ashes, the peacock, all symbols of Lucifer.
All symbols of Lucifer, claims Walter Veith. And it's true that you don't have to stray too far into the realms of the occult to uncover the association between Lucifer and the phoenix. I confess to being a long way out of my comfort zone here, but with everything that has happened since January 2020, and nearly everyone around me still in a deep trance-like, unreachable state, I am much more willing to go with my gut and accept possibilities I would have previously dismissed as nutjobbery. And now for a truly screwy representation of the phoenix, courtesy of the United Nations.
Not far from the meditation room is the United Nations Security Council chamber. This is the emergency room of the UN, where the world leaders meet when there is a threat to peace. They decide the fate of nations. Notice the giant mural that towers over the Security Council room. The central focus of the UN mural is the phoenix bird that has risen. The phoenix bird is a symbol of Lucifer. Egyptians believed that the phoenix symbolized a god who rose to heaven in the form of a morning star like Lucifer after his fire immolation of death and rebirth. Notice that the phoenix bird is not standing above his own ashes. He is standing above his old skin. Like a snake, he has shed his old skin and is revealing himself as God at the center of the mural.
Wikipedia provides the official interpretation of the phoenix in the mural as follows. The Norwegian artist Krog wanted to display an image of the future world in which the United Nations would save the world, just as according to his Christian belief, Jesus Christ saved the world. This is demonstrated through his use of a framework of Christian iconography where he has replaced Christ with a rising phoenix. Interesting that Wikipedia makes no mention of the shedding of the skin, which you have to admit is both peculiar and macabre, and surely requires some explanation. And the rest of the mural is really very strange too. Although it clearly has many biblical references and overtones, they are twisted and distorted into something else, and the sheer size of it makes for an unsettling presence in the room, which delegates of the Security Council chamber must find hard to tune out. Back to Freemasonry. While chasing down references to the Phoenix, it didn't take me long to stumble upon this. Now, as with everything to do with Freemasonry, things get tangled in knots almost immediately, so I'm not going to get too hung up on this, but I do think it's worth a mention. This is the double-headed eagle insignia of the Scottish Rite, home of the infamous 33rd degree Freemasons. And although it does indeed appear to be an eagle, some suggest that it actually represents the phoenix. But whether phoenix or eagle, the translation of the accompanying motto is beyond doubt. Ordo ab chao, order from chaos. Moving on from the religious and Masonic, it's evident that secular society has also taken to the iconic firebird, and in recent years you see it popping up all over the place. At heart, the legend of the phoenix is both powerful and easy to grasp. A beautiful unearthly bird dies a fiery death of spontaneous combustion before rising again from its own ashes. And the image of the phoenix has come to be used as a standalone symbol to express something yet simpler. From the depths of ruin and destruction emerges the opportunity for rebirth and restoration. My search turned up one very concrete reference to the phoenix, which I find hard to dismiss, and here it is. In September 1988, The Economist magazine published an article entitled Get Ready for a World Currency, Get Ready for the Phoenix. The front cover depicts an eagle-like phoenix rising from the ashes of a pile of burning cash. The original article is still available to download as a PDF, and it says, 30 years from now, Americans, Japanese, Europeans, and people in many other rich countries, and some relatively poor ones, will probably be paying for their shopping with the same currency. Prices will be quoted not in dollars, yen, or D-marks, but in, let's say, the Phoenix. The Phoenix Zone would impose tight constraints on national governments. There would be no such thing, for instance, as national monetary policy. The world phoenix supply would be fixed by a new central bank descended perhaps from the IMF. And the article ends with, pencil in the phoenix for around 2018 and welcome it when it comes. Well, a slight overshoot perhaps, but the drumbeat of rhetoric from central banks about moving towards a new global monetary system is steadily picking up pace. So are we on the threshold of a currency revolution? It certainly looks possible. I am well aware that I've gone on a circuitous and at times fanciful route to reach this point, so I will pull back to square one and end with this. In 2017, the BBC commissioned a team of academics to carry out a simulation exercise to predict the impact of the next pandemic more accurately than ever before. The resulting TV programme, fronted by mathematician Hannah Fry, was broadcast on the 22nd of March 2018. The fictional epidemic was seeded in the small market town of Haslemere and then spread via a smartphone app downloaded by thousands of volunteers around the UK. On the day the programme was broadcast, the Epidemics Journal published a paper entitled The Model Behind the BBC4 Pandemic, authored by the maths team who appeared alongside Hannah in the BBC documentary. The editor-in-chief of Epidemics at the time was Professor Neil Ferguson. Then in December 2019, the BBC broadcast the Royal Institution Christmas Lectures entitled Secrets and Lies, the Hidden Power of Maths, presented by Hannah Fry. The promotional shots and overall branding gave a mysterious occultish overtone to the shows. The first lecture featured a demonstration of the spread of a zombie viral pathogen through the audience. Vaccine protection from the zombie germs was demonstrated by providing some of the kids in the audience with a now familiar blue magic mask. A repeat of the BBC pandemic simulation documentary was shown on the 11th of February 2020. Then, in a bizarre twist, the town of Haslemere made headlines as the location of the UK's first case of community transmission of COVID-19 on the 28th of February 2020. This was the moment when the starting pistol on the pandemic in the UK was fired, and newsreaders began the daily ritual of announcing the tally of cases, which quickly rose from dozens to hundreds, then thousands, and 24/7 media coverage stoked the fears of the UK population to fever pitch. The contrived nature of this seemingly exponential explosion of cases was later revealed to be the result of a sudden and massive acceleration of the testing programme by Public Health England. This must have been known to the experts and policymakers at the time. Just 2 weeks later, the Imperial College London COVID-19 response team published its now notorious report containing the statement that, in total, in an unmitigated epidemic, we would predict approximately 510,000 deaths in Great Britain and 2.2 million in the United States. This caused the UK government to abandon its carefully planned pandemic preparedness strategy and dramatically switch course to emergency full-blown lockdown. The Ferguson report also received major coverage across the pond, causing a similar reaction in the American population. This complex interplay of fiction and reality involving the BBC, Neil Ferguson, Hannah Fry and her maths team was pivotal to the unfolding of the UK COVID-19 narrative and government policy, and it did not happen by spooky coincidence. This crucial opening sequence to the global COVID show was well orchestrated and years in the planning. And hats off to the artistic director, it was indeed a very impressive piece of theatre. And if you think I have overstated my case and that there is nothing fictitious about the COVID pandemic, consider this. In September 2020, Hannah Fry was the keynote speaker at Big Data London, the UK's largest data and analytics event, at which Fry said that the data generated by the experiment was used to inform policy during the COVID-19 pandemic as the basis of many of the papers government decisions have been based on. And on April 1st, 2021, this claim was confirmed on her own website. In 2018, Hannah made a documentary called Contagion, the BBC4 Pandemic. Fast forward to 2020, when the idea of a pandemic shifted out of the realm of fiction and became very, very real. But although the show's pandemic was fictional, the data was not. And the team were able to use everything they collected for the programme to model the real-world pandemic, which set a new gold standard on which the trajectory of the UK response was based. Let that sink in for a moment. Everything the BBC collected from the thousands of volunteers they had recruited for a TV programme on the pretext that they were participating in a fictional pandemic simulation exercise, was used to model the COVID-19 pandemic, and this altered the trajectory of the UK government's response. In February 2020, the press ran headlines about the scramble to find Britain's COVID pandemic patient zero. That person was never found. And in truth, There was really only ever one patient zero, and that was Hannah Fry.
There is a really simple point in all of this. If you've got maths on your side, it's not just about spotting patterns. It's about using what the numbers tell you to bend the world to your will.
Yeah.